Oh, hello everyone, and welcome back here to Minecraft on the Iris server. I know it's been a little while since the last time I made one of these, and I apologize again. I keep saying I'm going to be making some more, and something comes up and I can't. I've been working on something really, really big, and I think something you guys might be quite interested in. However, it's still a bit up in the air, so I'm going to drop hints during this episode, perhaps, and... Well, we'll come back to it later on, and you'll be hearing more and more about this over the next few weeks, so I kind of hope you guys are interested. So, since the last time we spoke, I've been working just a tiny bit on this place here. I've added the ceilings, added much of the floors. The staircase is now all the way in. You don't have to jump onto a ladder. It's getting there. It's starting to look like I want it to do, and I've started setting up the boxes from, the chests from my old base here, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this level and the ones above it and just lay them out with chests like this, I think. And each floor will have a different one, so this one will be for masonry, dirt, blocks, things like that. The one above will be for crafting items, your redstones, your irons, your golds, things like that. And the top one for food, and I will put the stuff in needed to craft that stuff on each floor. But let's get the crosshair back. That's right. Okay. Today I want to work a little bit on this one. My number one task on my list of things that I would like to do first is finish the walls. Okay. This was a great idea of, well, it's not exactly a novel idea, but it was a good idea of Dragonwolf Tamer. If you just take some time and build some walls around the spawn village, then as long as things are lit up inside, and they're overly lit up inside, to be totally honest with you at the moment, as long as things are lit up inside, then we don't have to worry about monsters coming in and beating us over the head or walking out the front door and have a creeper exploding out the front of our house and things like that. And that's a very good point. That's a very good point indeed. So we've been working, when I say we, I mean me. The guys were really, really helpful at the start, but it's kind of become my job now. And I've been doing an awful lot of this now. I think about, I'd say, three quarters, four fifths, about that mark of the walls are now done. They're built all around. It's still rough in areas. I mean, if you look down here, for example, that's a bit odd. And there's an area over there which hasn't quite been finished yet, which I need to do some work on. And I have not touched a single one of the gatehouses. The gatehouses being tasks that I'm hoping that the other people on the servers will take up. Yeah, each person take a gatehouse and design it and build it to their own style. All I really wish for them is the fact that mobs can't get through them and players can. It's as simple as that. So I'm hoping to see more of that. Do you know what I'm thinking here? What might be fun here is if we just put some ladders here. Yeah, I think I like that. So just have another way to get up. Like that. There we go. And we're back up again. Okay. Before we get on with the building, which we will be doing very, very soon. Mostly because I want to talk to you guys about a few bits and pieces I hope you will be interested in. But I want to do it while we're doing something else. This place is getting a bit laggy now, isn't it? 10 FPS, 8 FPS. Yes, you can tell this is a 1.8 server. Alright, so in we go. Yeah, the mailing boxes are all finished now. We have 16 of them. These 8 for the people who live in spawn towers, and these 8 for people who don't. And we've had a few new people floating around for a while. Some of them have finished their rooms, some of them have not. And Mega Racer said that the next time I record, I should have a look at his place. So let's have a look at his place, shall we? Welcome to the new lair, NWO lair. Signed, Mega Racer, NWO for life. Okay. Right, let's see what he's done with the place, shall we? That little living room. TV on the wall. The bed, sideboards, chest of drawers here. And yeah, little kitcheny type thing there. I think that's quite pleasant. That's nice, open and light. And is there anything out here? Nope. This is just a place for standing and breathing deep of the fresh air. And that's perfectly fine. Yeah, nice, simple building here, Mega Racer. Good job. I think you've done an excellent job. I do quite like the colour of the flooring as well. So, yeah, well done there, matey. Well done. There is one other person with a room under development at the moment. And this is Rory Sims. And she's taken down the sign saying, do not enter. But she hasn't actually said, hey, you can go in there and record. So I will come back later on and have a chat with her and ask if she doesn't mind me having a look in there. And assuming, of course, she says, no, it's quite all right. You'll see that one next time. Right. The gullen are aplenty. The gullen lay their eggs in the water. Probably a good thing the gullen can swim, I don't know. So here we are. This is all going to be changing soon. Slimy Jr., unfortunately, is going to have to come down. He was only supposed to be up there for a month at Christmas, and he's lasted about half a year, so hasn't done badly, has he? And there, so this is all looking good. And I flattened all this out. I think you guys have seen this before, but I'll just look at it again. I'll flatten this out here. But this is the thing that's going to be interesting us this time round, is this bit of wall here. So because we've got another shelf here, it's going to make the walls a little bit difficult to do, but I think we can do it. So I need to finish off that wall. There's a tiny bit that needs to be done on this one, and hopefully by the end of the episode we'll be doing this diagonal wall here, which is going to be a bit weird. But let's crack on with this, shall we? And what I need for this is some cobblestone. So let's go and get some of that. And what I need precisely is cobblestone fencing. Oh, I've got some cobblestone there. Let's use that. So we'll just make some fences. 60. Yeah, that's probably do me. Say that and I'll end up making some more. You know how it is. So the cobblestone goes all the way down the front, which is what I do is we put the fences down in a pattern that allows us to easily put some lights on, but at the same time makes it very, very hard for spiders to climb up. And that's the final bit, because the walls without the pattern on the front will still be climbable by spiders, which is exactly what we don't want. So you are laggy today, aren't you? Let's see what it looks like out here. So we've done the bottom bit and the lights. All we need to do is put the fencing on the top, the final set of lights, and that section's done. And then we'll do this section, and then we'll do the diagonals. Now, stuff that I want to talk about. The first one is something that's rather annoying me, and I'd like you guys to think about this and, you know, give me your feedback on it, and perhaps voice your displeasure with the manufacturers you like. Mojang has announced that in the next year, Scrolls is going to be disbanded. They're going to turn the servers off. And because it's an online-only game, that means no more games will be played ever. So if you have liked the games that I've been playing with Young Tort, enjoy them. Make the most of them, because they're going to be the last you're ever going to see, I'm afraid. It's as simple as that. Without the servers, and unless Mojang does something like open source the code or make the code available to fans to play, it's the end of it, to be totally honest to you. It's disappointing, it's surprising, because there is enough people that really, really like Scrolls. There's enough people out there playing the game all over the place. There's loads and loads of people that to challenge, to play online. There's no reason in my mind whatsoever, apart from the fact that Microsoft bought Mojang, and what they didn't want was a card game. And unfortunately, that is probably the thing that's killing it. And I don't want to blame I don't want to blame Microsoft for everything. That's too easy to do. Microsoft, let's face it, they're the evil prince of the computing world, but And this is someone who has worked in the web development industry and has really suffered because Microsoft decided to do their own thing. They're not for blame for everything. They're a company, they're doing their own things, and they act on commercial interests. It's up to us players. If we don't like something, it's up to us players to make sure that the industry doesn't know this, because the industry is, well, let's be totally honest with you, the industry is cowardly. It has to be. The industry can't work too hard on doing things that people dislike. If people jump up and down and say, "Hey, I don't like it," it's only when we allow the industry to dictate terms to say to us, to say to us that we will have DRM because it's our own good. And if you take DRM off, you're a terrorist or something equally stupid. And then that's the situation where we end up getting things done in our own name, but not in our interest, and that is always a wrong thing. This is a classic example here. We're having online only games. So you spend £50 on your game. It's an online only game. You can play it as long as the people who sold you the game say, "Hey, you know what? You can play this game." The second they decide, "I don't want to do it. It's not in the company's interest," or, "We're going to re-releasing episode version 2 of this game, and we don't want you to play this game. We want to play you to play our new game," then what is instantly going to happen is your game becomes unplayable. They turn the servers off, and away you go. You have no say. You have no recourse. You have no comeback. And the thing that galls me the most about this fact is the number of people that just say, "Well, yeah, they turned it off. It must be because the game is crap." It could be the case. It might not be the case. But for every game out there that you guys think is terrible, somebody is going to love it. Somebody is going to really enjoy that game. Okay, a classic example here is my very good friend Mod1982 off of Team Tuxedo. He is a massive fan of the old 16-bit Sonic games and just games in general from that era. I'm not. I never really liked Sonic. It was too shallow. It just relied on twitch reflexes, and I'm not a twitchy type person. And I just didn't find it fun. But I can respect the fact that somebody else liked it. Because that's what you need to do. You need to respect other people's opinions. And the fact that I don't like it doesn't mean that I should be happy that it got turned off. It's a complete opposite, to be totally honest with you. We need to. How did you get in here? Go. No, go away. Yeah, that taught you. Oh, we need to respect this. We need to be the sort of people that respect the fact that other people have likes, because sooner or later our likes are going to be challenged, and why should they help us if we didn't help them? It's as simple as that, really, isn't it? Anyway, I digress a little bit. All right. The point I want to make here really is the fact that if we allow games to have a limited lifespan, if we don't shout out when a game gets killed. EA are closing down a number of games today, including, was it Need for Speed World and a few other bits and pieces. They're not things that I particularly am interested in, but even though I'm not particularly interested in the games, I am particularly interested in the concept, because there are games out there that I really like that, because of the nature of the way I play games, are actually quite marginal. But there's also big ones. I spent £100 backing Elite Dangerous. Elite Dangerous has a shared server login. Eventually, that game will go away. And the annoying thing here is that game is only going to last as long as people think that the profit is worth the effort. Which could be today, could be next week, could be 10 years from now. But the chances are it's only going to be 4 or 5 years. So you've just spent 30, 40, £50 dollars, rubles, chickens, whatever, on this game. And you're not buying it, you're renting it. I know the end user license agreements have been saying that for years, but the simple fact of the matter is, single player games cannot be taken away from you. It's as simple as that. Okay, a game that exists on your server cannot be taken away from you. And that is the right thing to do. I still play games that were made 10 years ago plus. System Shock 2, Theme Hospital. Theme Hospital is so good. Even though it's so a very old a game, I am seriously giving thought to doing a Let's Play on it. And I think you guys would actually really like it. But I can't do that in a game that I'm relying on a server for. This is because the second the server gets off, the game goes away. There are a few exceptions to this. Hellgate London, okay, is a good one. Hellgate London was made by some of the same team that made Diablo and Diablo 2. And it was an interesting game, but I got to be honest with you, the developers got the pricing model wrong. Let's put it that way, okay? And when they brought it out, they started saying to people, you know what? We are so confident this game is going to be great that we're going to charge you per year for it. And we'll even give out £100 for a lifetime membership. So you've bought the game, and now we're going to expect you to pay yearly for access. Didn't quite work out. I mean, yeah, okay, I know people play World of Warcraft for now these days, and they're a bit more used to monthly payments, but at the time this was a fairly new idea, and they didn't offer enough for it to be worthwhile, and people didn't buy it, and as a result they went out of business and they had to shut the servers down, which is quite understandable. Problem was that it was actually quite a good game, in all honesty. It was quite enjoyable, Hellgate London. A lot of people really did like it. So fans sat down and actually developed a Hellgate server. So as long as you had the original game, you could log on to this fan-made server and still play the game. And as my understanding is, that still exists today. I haven't played on it for a while, but I'm assuming it's still there. And that is great, because that's extended the life of it. But you can't expect that to happen on every server. If World of Warcraft went down, okay, somebody would have a server emulator up within a month. Okay, but yeah, a fairly large percentage of the world population plays World of Warcraft. EVE Online already has an EVE emulator. If for some reason EVE servers go down, go away. Sort of. If for some reason EVE servers ever go down, there is already something sitting out there in the wings, waiting for the day when that happens, and it will be turned on, and the EVE Online players will be able to carry on playing quite merrily, and that's great. But Need for Speed Online, that's dead. That's gone. And please bear in mind, it's not actually a game I liked. I did not like it in the slightest. I think it was a terrible game. It just happens to be an example. Okay, it happens to be an example of a problem which is endemic in gaming society at the moment, I think. And that is, it's in all honesty, what bothers me. So, that's the reason why I'm harping on about this, and I apologize if I'm boring you. I do consider it to be an important matter, though. And we as gamers need to start saying, no, I don't like this. Yeah. Game designers, give us games that will last. Don't give us this rubbish. Give us things that we can play and we can carry on playing. I mean, come on. £50 or $50 or 50 whatevers, it's not pennies. It's not small amounts of money. It is enough money to be a reasonable investment for most people. And not everybody out there has a nice, comfortable job with enough spare income to be able to purchase games at a whim. These are expensive enough that playing these games is actually an investment in time, money, and effort. And saying to people, yeah, okay, you can play this game. Thank you for the large amounts of money you've just given us. But we're just going to turn this off now because we're bored with it. That's wrong, and that's unfair, and that's unpleasant, and that's yet another example of where the gaming industry is not going in a direction which is to benefit gamers. And that just strikes me as unfairness, hubris even, of the worst sort, because what they're saying, guys, and this should bother you, is they're saying gamers do not matter. You do not matter in the big scheme of things because, you know, you've given us your money and now we can just do what we want and you will not have a leg to stand on because your gamers and your voice does not matter. Is that what you'd like? I don't think so. The only way we're ever going to start dealing with this is by us all jumping up and down and saying, for crying out loud, you're supposed to be working for us. You are supposed to be providing things that we enjoy, that we get fun out of. But you're not. You're not even trying anymore. So stop doing games aimed at the lowest common denominators. Stop doing games with hidden transactions. We've given you enough money already. Stop doing things in such a... Stop doing DRM that's tied into servers, knowing full well that the game will die the second you turn the server off. This is not good practice. Would you buy a car that broke after 100 miles guaranteed? Okay, even if that car only cost you £50, would you drive a car that would only work for 100 or 1,000 or 10,000 miles? Not. Would you buy furniture or a toaster or a DVD player which is only going to last for 6 months and which the manufacturers of the videos can reach over the internet and turn it off at whim? You would not. Would you buy a book which disintegrated after 2 years? You wouldn't. So why does it work with computer games? And the answer is simple. Because we let it. And we have to stop. We have to stop saying to allowing the gaming manufacturers to say, we're in control. This is not your game. You gave us lots of money, but you didn't actually buy it. And so therefore, we can do whatever we want with it, and you do not have a leg to stand on. It's just wrong, and it's just unfair, and it's just a ridiculous business practice which only works because we let them get away with it. So it's time for us to start saying, you can't do that, stop doing it, or words to that effect. So, I'm sorry, I've been on my soapbox for how long? Last 23 minutes. Okay, this episode is actually getting nearly over now. I do apologize if I've bored you, but if you're a gamer and what I've said has bored you, you need to start seriously thinking about your attitude as a gamer. I've got to be honest with you, because you are not helping... Actually, I decided let's put matters here. You are not helping the gaming world become something that is honest, wholesome, and good. Most of the games made today with online that are online only will never be being played in 15 years' time by the mod 1982s of their generations, because these games just simply will no longer work. Okay, so you guys, your children, will never get to see the classics that made you excited as a young gamer. And that's just wrong. It doesn't matter if they're good or bad, that's irrelevant. It's the fact that it's there for posterity. How how would it be if Lord of the Rings, there you go, classic book, absolutely fantastic book. Okay, it's coming up to what, 80, 90 years old now. How would it be if nobody could read that anymore because it was too old and the Tolkien family decided to pull it from distribution? Possibly because there was a team of young and thrusting developers in Brisbane working on The Lord of the Rings too. I don't know why I said Brisbane, it's irrelevant. But it's exactly the same point. Another set of walls. So I think I'm going to leave that one there because there is actually another thing I wanted to talk to you guys about. Yes, I know, I'm sorry, just adding to the horror, I appreciate that. So, what do I want to talk to you about? Yes, I have been working on a couple of things recently, and they have taken up an awful lot of my time, and as a result, I haven't been doing a lot of the gaming videos that you guys come to expect of me, and I apologize for that, and I'm most grateful to everybody who has been patient. Because I've been throwing up bits and pieces of the live streams and doing some stuff and doing some extra live streams and that to make up for it. But I haven't actually had the time to sit down and play, yeah, the Minecraft type games, which are loads of fun and really, really enjoyable to play, but take an awful lot. This 25, 30 minute episode, once you take into account setting it up and things like that, it's actually going to take me about 2 hours to record, another hour to set the editing up and things like that. And so eventually this game, this one episode is going to be, it's going to take, I should imagine, a good 3 hours of my life to get ready. And not recently, for very good reasons, I think, or at least I believe. Go, thank you. Is that enough? 1, 2, 3. Yeah, I think that might be enough. Let's move that one. Yeah. Okay, that's not going to work. Okay, so yeah, taken up a huge amount of my time, and it's just been impossible for me to get everything done, which is a shame. But but we're getting close to the end of that now, and over the next few weeks we're going to be doing some announcements. A lot of YouTubers I have a lot associations with, we have been working on something that I'm really, really excited about. We as developers have all talked about depression quite a lot, and a lot of us have suffered from it. A lot of us know people who have suffered from it, and you know, we've all had it affecting people in our lives. And the interesting thing here is that when I do live streams, a lot of people talk about their experiences of depression and the problems in their lives. Sometimes because they know we have experience of it, sometimes because they have no one else to talk to. And as a result, and based upon an interesting comment from BitLate to the game, thank you BitLate, I really, really do appreciate you coming to me with this, we have decided to do a long time live stream. So we're talking 12 hours plus of a number of gamers, British and American, playing games. And we're going to tie that in with, we are going to tie that in with, let's do, no, I'll tell you what we'll do. I'm going to extend the sandstone back there. So let's take that one back off. Right, okay, yeah. So what are we going to do, and I will get to the point, I do apologize, is we are going to do a 12-hour live stream. So the 12-hour live stream will consist of your favorite YouTubers doing games. We will probably get round to doing... Oh, that does work here. We'll be getting around to doing the Euro Truck Simulator race across Europe. Will be one of the things we're doing. I've been talking to a number of simmers to play their popular games. At least one other member of the Naughty Trio has confirmed that they will be along for it, so you can expect some simming and some other games. And at the same time, what we're trying to do is we've approached a number of different charitable organizations, like Papyrus, or there's a number of others that I can't confirm that we are talking to yet. And these hopefully will provide us with experts in talking about issues around depression, and people who can provide forums, who can provide expert opinion, and just basically help anyone who has suffered from depression who could use some advice and, you know, perhaps a little bit of hand-holding from these people. And so far, it's coming together quite well. We are still in a very infantile stage on this. But I am very, very much hoping that this will be set up and running soon. And we are aiming to do the live stream at the end of September. The absolute date will be confirmed, hopefully, very, very soon. Does look a bit wrong there, but I think that's close enough. So that has been taking up an awful lot of my time, and thank you very much, everybody, for your patience, your understanding of the fact that I haven't been quite as productive as I used to be. I hope this news and a few other things that we'll be doing recently will help make up for that. And I hope that you guys will come along to the live streams. We'll come and see your favorite YouTubers and me doing stuff. We'll contribute, not just financially, okay? We need people to come along and talk about their experiences. We're going to need people to come along and help us by we'll be looking for moderators, we'll be looking for sort of other people to come along. We're going to be selling games, and the actual games are to be confirmed yet, but hopefully over the next couple of weeks I will be setting up a procedure where people can purchase a whitelist to a game and come along and play it. I'm kind of hoping that there'll be a Minecrafty one. One of the ones we would love to do is Town of Salem will be another one that's going we're going to set up. So depending on the number of people that buy into these games, we'll be able to play these games with some YouTubers, with a few other people. On the event day, and occasionally you'll end up on the live stream yourself, because we'll be coming onto these games and recording and basically just opening it up to people as well. And that'll be part of the event, part of the excitement. And I hope that people are going to be into this. I hope that people are going to enjoy this, because this whole issue is very, very important to me. This is a particular thing that I've suffered from in the past, depression. Compared to very many people, I've got it off incredibly lightly, incredibly mildly, but it still had a direct effect on my life. So I'm quite passionate about this problem, and I know that many people, myself especially included when I was younger, the way that people dealt with this was by telling you to man up. It's all in your mind. It's not real. It's just you being a whiny bitch. Possibly. But it feels real. Okay? I'm not saying that I wasn't a whiny bitch as well. I mean, I was a teenager once. Okay? But at the same time, these issues felt real to me, and these issues still feel real to me. And when something comes along and triggers me, and it can be the minorest thing, it's something that a couple of days later I can go back and think, well, yeah, okay, that did actually mildly annoy me, but it certainly wasn't worth all that overreaction. When that happens, I can't help but feel, you know, that the world is pressing down on me, and the world is out to get me, and it's just trying to make my life worse. And that is the problem with depression, is the feeling of isolation, of being on your own, of being put upon, of, you know, just feeling separated from everyone, of not being able to communicate your issues and communicate your problems. And there's no real way that people can easily deal with this. I mean, certainly not when you're younger. And believe me, it's not a problem that just ups and goes away as you get older. It's something that's there, and it's there for life. So one cannot just assume that you grow out of it. It's minor, it's mild. It's not. It's there, and it's there for life. And it's important to me to know that people are going to be able to feel supported, are going to be able to feel looked after. And if we can do something that will help that, and even just a small way, I think it's a wonderful thing. Okay, and yeah, I hope that you're going to be there. I hope you're going to participate. I hope you're going to enjoy. And I hope that it's going to touch you in such a way. I hope this is going to touch you in such a way that you will dip into your pockets and give to the causes. Now, money will be going to a number of different charities. Papyrus is probably going to be one, because we are already, Team Tuxedo and Mod in particular, already do gather money for that one. So that will be one. And I think we're also hoping to find... How are you hitting me? How I... I didn't want to come down here. You made me come... Yeah, I hope it's... This is going to touch people, and it's going to help people, and... I hope it's going to be good. And I've got to be honest with you, there's going to be some incredibly technical challenges, which are going to be fun for me, and just loads of fun all around. And I hope to see you there. But I'm well over my normal 30 minutes for a Minecraft episode now, so I think I'm going to call it there. I do apologize for ranting, and I thank you for those of you who've lasted this long for listening. And I hope this hasn't been too boring. This is an interesting part of the build, so I'm glad I had the chance to share it. There we go. Right. And I will finish this off before the next episode. And, well, if nothing else, I have an interesting plan for this clip corner here. So, if nothing else, we might do that. But until then, I've been Simon Parsons. This has been Minecraft on the World of Iris. Thank you. And good night.